service. Let your spirit, O Lord, work the work that is intended to work. We believe you, Lord, for the great move of your spirit as we, your people, come together in this house and believe you for what you have in store for us. And for that, we thank you. We praise you and give you all glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Praise God. Would you clap your hands together right now in faith and believe God for this legacy service? Praise God. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, church. Remain standing tonight. We're so glad for each and every one of you here tonight. And we are excited to introduce you to our legacy service. I thought some time back, I would love to, our church is growing more seasoned every year. And I thank God for a strong apostolic church. I thank God for a strong church, a praying church, a Bible-believing church. And I'm thankful this church has stood for truth. It stood for holiness, soul winning. This church has loved souls, loved this apostolic truth. For 44 years, it's been preached here, starting at the First United Pentecostal Church, now at the Temple of Pentecost. And we celebrate that. Amen? Amen. So tonight, I want to have a legacy service. I want tonight there to be generational preaching that will go on here. Tonight, Brother Grant Wicker, who is fifth generation Pentecost, will be preaching. His son or daughter, which will be born next year, will be sixth generation apostolic. I thank God for these generations that continue. And he is a part of this church. He and Aaron are wonderful, wonderful part of our church. They help upstairs in our children's ministry, doing an incredible job. And so this is an exciting event here tonight. He will preach, and when he's done, we're going to have an apostolic worship service. How many remembers when we had the songbook? Now, we don't have songbooks to give you now. We still have the screen, but we're going to sing some songs that you haven't sung in a while. They still work. And we're going to worship. And we're going to give glory to God. We can worship with a new song and we can worship with an old song. In fact, Jeremiah was 14 years old when he said, "Give me the old past." He was just a young teenager. Give me those old past. And I'm thankful for a church that loves the legacy of apostolic outpouring. And so I want Brother Grant Wicker to come. He's going to kick off with a keynote this service. He's going to preach here a keynote message. We're going to go into our worship course, our worship set. And then Brother Wall will finish it up here preaching at the end. Put your hands together and welcome Brother Grant Wicker as he comes to minister.
Let's go ahead and give that to God. Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give you the glory, honor, and praise, Jesus, for generations that we're able to give it. It doesn't just stop with us. It keeps moving, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, for that opportunity, that it hasn't been taken away from us, Lord, but we are able to continue to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise in all things. Amen and amen. We're going to quickly get into the word tonight. If you have your Bibles, if you would turn with me to 1 Chronicles chapter 29. Beginning in verse number 1. And I would like to thank Pastor for this opportunity. It's something that I do not take lightly, and it's definitely a privilege and an honor. And, of course, Bishop and Sister Huntley, thank you for building this church and allowing us to build our ministry for not just those that are already in ministry, but those that are growing up. They get the opportunity to learn because of the foundation you laid. And, of course, I've been waiting to say this since I got married. Brother Douglas, this is a sign for you. I would like to give honor to the unto the lovely and gracious Aaron Wicker. I've been waiting to say that since I got married, so there we go. All right, 1 Chronicles chapter 29 and verse number 1. Furthermore, David the king said unto all the congregation, Solomon my son, whom alone God hath chosen, is yet young and tender. And the work is great, for the palace is not for man, but for the Lord God. Now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God, the gold for things to be made of gold, and the silver of things for silver, and the brass of things of brass, the iron for things of iron, and wood for things of wood, onyx stones, and stones to be set, glistening stones, and of divers colors, and all manner of precious stones, and marble stones in abundance. Moreover, because I have set my affection to the house of my God, I have my own proper good of silver and gold, which I have given to the house of my God, over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house. Even 3,000 talents of gold, of the gold of Ophir, and 7,000 talents of refined silver, to overlay the walls of the houses withal. The gold for things of gold, and silver, and the silver for things of silver, and for all manner of work to be made by the hands of artificers. And who, then, is willing to consecrate his service this day unto the Lord? And now I'm going to jump to 2 Chronicles chapter 3, in verses 1 and 2. Then Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem in Mount Moriah, where the Lord appeared unto David his father, in the place that David had prepared, and the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite. And he began to build in the second day of the second month, in the fourth year of his reign. And I would like to speak for a few moments on the subject, from legacy to identity. From legacy to identity. You may be seated. We join in this story, and David's an old man. He's been king for many years, and he's getting close to the end of his reign. He's about to go on and be taken up. However, David, during his tenure as king, had a desire to build the temple for God. You see, there was no temple for him. There was just the place that Moses had set up many, many, many years ago. There was no house for him, truly, to be worshipped in. But David, we all know, was a man of war. If you go and read through 1 and 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles, we see that David is constantly in war. I mean, his own son went to war with him over being king. I mean, you know, and so God said, David, you can't build this. You're a man of war. There's blood on your hands. You can't do it. Now, at this point, David could have been upset. He could have said, I want to build it. I'm going to build it. I got all these materials together. Like, why can't I do it? But he didn't do that. See, David said, okay, I may not be able to build it, but I'm going to get everything that I can in preparation for it. Even though David was never going to be able to step foot into this temple that he so much desired to build for God, he still did everything he could to make sure that someday someone else could. He made sure, he wanted to make sure that everything was in place. And you see, after King David died, his son Solomon, of course, became king. And Solomon must have felt a lot of pressure. You see, that proclamation that we read in the first section of our scripture in 1 Chronicles chapter 29, we see that David is proclaiming this to all of Israel. He's saying, hey, I can't build it, but I'm getting everything ready for it. I'm getting it all ready. For my son Solomon, he even says Solomon's going to be king next. God anointed him. He already knew. Before he even died, he told them that. So Solomon becomes king and probably feels the pressure. People have been waiting for this temple to be built for so long, and they know that Solomon's going to be the one to build it. So, I mean, I can't imagine being put in that place like, okay, now I got to deliver. I got to step up to the plate and actually, you know, hit the ball, get on base. But you see, Solomon didn't just build the temple because David prepared it for him. He could have chosen to take those materials and build him a nice big palace. He could have chosen to use those materials for anything he wanted. He could have built some place to glorify himself. But it was at this moment when Solomon began and built this temple and used these materials as they were intended, that it went from David's legacy of building the temple to Solomon's identity of actually doing it. David laid the foundation for Solomon. Even says that it was at the foundation of the threshing floor in 2 Chronicles. But David couldn't build it. But Solomon said, it's the legacy that I've been given that I'm going to make my own. We have to be able to make our own. We have to make the legacy that our grandfathers and our grandparents and our parents made for us into our own identity. You see, we have no choice. No one can force you to do this. No one can force you to do anything. No one can force you to accept God and actually live this doctrine that we have. Your parents can pray for you. Your parents can sit there and guide you. Your pastor can pray for you. But ultimately, only us ourselves can make that distinction to say, hey, this is for me. It isn't just for them. It's for me too. We have to make that distinction. We have to make that choice and say, hey, I want it. And not just because it's for us, but because it needs to go further beyond us. In fact, we should never say that the standard of our predecessors was only for them. If we ever say, hey, you know, I don't think that we need to do that standard anymore, we're in trouble. We're already too far gone. It's already over. Every standard that pastor set forth or bishop has set forth isn't just for our grandparents or our parents, it's also for us. And we have to make that distinction and choice too. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 18 says, for verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Plain and simple. It says it right there. We can't give even an inch of it. We can't exclude one verse just because we don't like the way it says what it says. We have to accept it as the whole. We can't jot it out. If it's in the Bible, it's for us too. This was a living word. It was written over 2,000 years ago, and yet it's still applicable every single day. Every time we open the Bible, we say, wow, I just talked to somebody down the street about that. This is going on in my life, and yet it was written about 2,000 plus years ago. Actually, me and my wife started a Bible study with someone at her work, and we had a session on Friday night, and I remember talking about this, how the word was a living word, and that it's applicable continuously. And it's like, no matter where you go and what time frame you live in, and we looked at all throughout history, no other book has stayed the same. No other book has remained as true as the Bible is through no matter what. In fact, it gives an example in the search for truth that we're doing that says a science book was published in, what was it, the 1800s? And it had all these declared scientific facts, had 50 of them. Today, none of those facts are true. We found out it ain't true. However, this is still true. It hasn't changed once. It hasn't needed to be changed. It's still the same as it was 2,000 years ago. It was good enough for them. It's good enough for me. We need to have it good enough for all of us. It shouldn't end then. It should keep going until God comes back. Luke chapter 24 and verse 35 says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. I remember that verse from Bible quizzing. It was the last verse of my first year Bible quizzing back when I was 7 or 8 years old. And it stuck with me because no matter what this word's saying here, no matter what this word's saying, heaven and earth can go away and everything else can fail. But this word shall stand forever beyond heaven, beyond earth, beyond hell. Everything relies on this word. If you have an apostolic Pentecostal legacy, you are blessed. There are people who don't have that. We have it, and we are blessed. You see, I have a legacy, as Pastor said, of being fifth generation. And now, I know that I can't let this legacy end with me. I can't stop here. You see, Pastor also mentioned I have a son on the way. We announced yesterday, so I have a son on the way. And I can't let this legacy that I've been handed end at five. I can't let it say, okay, fifth is good enough for me. Let's end it here. I have to make it my identity so that way I can pass on this legacy to my son. I can't be the reason this legacy ends. If I am living one way at the church and I go home and act another way and my child sees it, that isn't carrying on that legacy, is it? Mm-mm. He's going to be confused. He's going to say, hold up, why do we act this way here when everyone's watching, but act a different way in the quiet place, in the place where no one else can see but God? You see, it doesn't matter if you're in a quiet place at home or if you're in the public in church. You need to act the same way, because if you don't, your children won't carry on this legacy for you. There will be no one to carry it on if you aren't truthful in here, out there. It doesn't matter. We're not in this world. We're not of this world. We're here to make a difference in this world. All of you that have children or are about to have a child, we have quite a lot of biological growth going on in here. Jason and Michaela, you guys are expecting one right before us, and of course me and Aaron are, and it's wonderful. But we have to be careful. We have to make sure that this legacy that our parents built for us and our ancestors built for us doesn't end with us. We have to show them. We have to show them how to carry on this legacy, how to make this legacy their identity. And, you know, this was kind of well-timed for a legacy service because last week, Sister Maria and Sister Michaela Moore basically was going on about talking about Brother Batts' legacy at his funeral. And it was beautiful. And I was like, right there, as soon as they started speaking about it, I'm like, wait a minute. God's already laid this on my heart. I had already written this that Tuesday before that. And yet God was sitting there confirming it already, saying, hold up. This legacy's got to keep going. It can't stop here. So Michaela and Maria, God was talking to y'all. I don't even know if you know it, but he was talking to you already. He was already telling you this legacy that Brother Batts had needs to keep carrying on. Not just for you, but for your grandchildren and your children, because they are going to be the ones that carry it on. But even if your parents weren't in the church, even if you weren't raised in the church, because my wife wasn't. She came in later on in life. She wasn't raised in the church. Doesn't mean you don't have a legacy. There's a very specific legacy that all of us share, no matter what. And that legacy can be found in Acts chapter 2, in verse 38 and verse 39. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And the power, and the promises unto you, and power, and the promise unto you and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. It doesn't matter if you walked in this truth today, yesterday, or 1,000 years ago. It doesn't matter when you got in it, when your family got in it. You still have this same legacy. No one is exempt from this. It's for eternal. Always, this word is holding on and saying, hey, this promise is for you and for your children and for all that are afar off. We have to claim this legacy that God gave us and make it our own identity. We have to live this identity all the days of our lives. I talked about Solomon at the beginning, and sadly, he didn't. He made it his identity at the beginning, but in the end, he didn't. He walked away. He decided that something else was better than God. And I don't know how you make that distinction. Wasn't for a wise man, he made a pretty bad choice there at the end. We have the opportunity to continue to make this legacy that we have into our identity. But we can't just do it today and say, forget it tomorrow. Mm-mm. That's still going to lead us to failure. That means that our children won't be able to carry on this legacy. They won't have a legacy to carry on. They'll have to build their own again. We have to make this legacy our identity. From the very beginning, every day, say, Lord, I want this to be mine. It has to be mine. I can't let it go a day without saying, it's mine. And we must continue to build and let this legacy grow each and every day.
Worthy to be praised. There's one legacy that we should never forget to do, and that when it comes to praising our God, we should never forget to bless his name. We should never forget to lift him up and to give him all the glory and all the honor that he's so worthy of. Somebody say, so I will bless the name of Jesus. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. I will bless that wonderful name of Jesus. There's no other name I know. Oh,
will bless you. Every day of my life I'll bless you. I'll sing the praise. So when we figure out how to draw close to God, and that's the first key to finding every answer that you would ever have in your life. And this song is inviting you to just come close to Him. So as we sing this song tonight, I want you to realize that it's not for my neighbor only, but it's for me also. And if I could just get close enough to Him, then every problem I have will be solved. My
David made it clear. He said, "One thing have I desired." There should be one central thought in our mind tonight. We are here collectively as a body, but our minds can be scattered. But as our hearts are brought in tune with the Holy Ghost, there should be one desire that we may dwell, that we may dwell in the presence of the Lord. There's something beautiful going on in this house tonight. I wonder if we could lift our hands together right now all across this building and affirm that desire unto the Lord. I want to dwell. I want to live in your presence. I want to wake up with you on my mind. I want to walk through the day with you on my mind. I want to lay my head down at night with you on my mind, that I might dwell in your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. as Bishop preached this morning, the beautiful part about dwelling in the presence of God is that we don't do it alone. We do it together. You and I have been brought into this thing together. And together, the Lord says, we're going to be raised. We're going to leave here in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. We're going to be caught up together. Together with these of like precious faith. Oh, clap your hands unto the Lord tonight. Let's magnify the Lord together. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We love you, Lord, and praise you tonight. Thank you for my brother. Thank you for my sister with whom we worship you tonight. Praise God, praise God. What a beautiful presence of the Lord is in this house. God bless you as you return to your seats tonight. Praise God, from the oldest to the youngest. Our desire is unto the Lord for God's will to be accomplished in our life. Every aspect of our lives we dedicate unto Him tonight. Praise God. Thank you, praise team, for taking us back a few years. This is what it was built on, Bishop Huntley. And this is what it'll continue on, Pastor Ballesteros. Our desires unto the Lord. Praise God. Ushers, if you will prepare to wait on us for our evening gifts, tithes, and offerings. It's the faithfulness of the Temple of Pentecost that allows this beautiful gospel to be preached around the world. There are those that have gone out from among us that now carry this beautiful gospel to parts of the earth that we could not otherwise have the privilege or opportunity to go or be in, but because of your faithfulness, it's being made possible tonight. Would you pray with me right now? Thank you, Lord, for the privilege we have to stand before you. With our gifts and the thankful heart we give unto you, we might not be able to go, but Lord, we make it possible for others. And we thank you for that privilege tonight. For indeed, our fingerprints are on souls around the world. And we thank you for it tonight. Praise God. And everyone said, in Jesus' name, God bless you as you give tonight. Your faithfulness to the kingdom of God, being a blessing to the work of God. Praise God. There are a few announcements that I'd like to just bring your attention to. Of course, this Wednesday night, a great time here at the Temple of Pentecost with all of our heroes. And I say that very respectfully, in training. It'll be a great time this Wednesday night with heroes in training. It'll be an opportunity for the next generation to bless the kingdom of God with their talents, their gifts, and however they desire to do so. Amen. Of course, October the 9th, a great time here at the Temple of Pentecost annually, Miracle Opportunity Sunday. A great time to introduce those that need a miracle to the miracle worker. Amen. And I believe great things are going to transpire. There has been much prayer, fasting that has taken place prior to this opportunity. And I know God is going to honor that. October 28th, there are still yet tickets to be sold, to be bought, purchased. As Brother Nakota Blues Live recording project looms here on the horizon, October the 28th. If you have not purchased a ticket, please do so. Bless the kingdom of God, the work of God. Can you say amen? Praise God, praise God. 20 years ago, the Top family was blessed with another family. Came into its fold. The patriarch of that family has not only been instrumental in leading his family, as represented here even in this pulpit as a keynote speaker tonight, Brother Grant Wicker, but also instrumental in leading many others in the ways of God and to love God in the way that he does. As the outreach director of the Temple of Pentecost, he's helped facilitate many of the endeavors, this local assembly in our community. He is to the Wall Wicker family, father, grandfather, and soon to be great-grandfather. However, to the temple people, he's a man of God. He's an anointed preacher. He is a friend of ours. Would you stand with me right now and welcome Brother Toby Wall tonight to this pulpit?
Praise the Lord. I think that's the first time I ever had a woo. You may be seated. That was a number two, man. This is a legacy night. Earlier, Brother Mark was up here, and the praise singers were singing, and I was just looking for the higher pins to start flying, and I had to start ducking. Hello. Some of the doilies coming out, and they're shaking them in their hand, whatever it was they did. I remember all that. I remember when you come and tarried for the Holy Ghost, man, you tarried. It was not minutes. It wasn't quarter of hours, but it was hours. Amen. And so this is a very fitting setting tonight. I remember when they tell you to get down and pray, you couldn't hardly stand back up because your knees have been down there and the blood circulation cut off and you fall over. You walk funny. Well, I got news for you. When you get older and you get out of your car after driving just to church, you walk funny. You stand still and everybody looking at you, won't you come on? My wife, she'll hop out. She just. And I'm sitting there, what are you coming? I said, as soon as I can get my legs under me, just a minute. Things change. Praise the Lord. But God is certainly good. I'm so proud of my grandson. Grant, love you. But not only that, I'm proud of all my grandchildren. Amber, I'm proud of you. Jordan was going to be here tonight, but for some reason he decided he'd get himself double infected with pink eye. So he's up at college. He was going to take off, come down, be with us through the weekend. But maybe he's watching online. I'm sure he probably will. Jordan, miss you, buddy. Love you. Proud of you. Amen. Bishop and Sister Huntley, there's no words that I could ever express how I love you and how I feel about you. You cared when many didn't. Because of that, I'll never forget that. But you know what that is? That's apostolic legacy. I tell you something else too. Anything that Bishop or Sister Bishop speaks into your life or speaks to you, that's apostolic legacy. And it don't come any higher order than that right there. Amen. Years ago, somebody asked me, said, aren't you very nervous when you get up to preach in front of Brother Huntley and he's there? I said, well, first and foremost, I'm nervous because I'm getting up in front of God and his people. I said, but I'm not nervous about Bishop Huntley. He said, why not? Aren't you intimidated? I said, nope. We both serve the same God. But even more than that, he's going to help me. He's always helped me. So he wouldn't stop tonight. To my pastor, Sister Ballastero, Christiana Huntley, to the boys, to every one of you, I'm so thankful for you and your apostolic history. Man, I tell you, they don't get many. I don't know. You guys have to get a calculator out when you start figuring out your legacy, I think. And you know what? We're blessed. And anything that they speak into your life, whether it be from the pulpit, on the side back here behind the wall, or hopefully not upstairs in the office, you better take it as an apostolic legacy. Oh, God. Praise God. Brother Batch, I know we've already mentioned him tonight, but You're probably going to hear a lot of things over that you've already heard from Bishop this morning and from tonight. And I'm not going to be real lengthy, so I told Bishop after service I either got confirmed or I need to go home and hit the delete button on my computer and start all over again. But sometimes out of the mouths of two or three, every word is established. But I think about Brother Batch and the legacy. Brother Tommy Batch, Sister Batch, we love you guys so much. And all your family. What a legacy. I think some of the last words he told my son, Brandon's been working with him for ushering for a long time. And every once in a while he thought Brother Batch was trying to get rid of him. But he was just showing his love. So Brandon would come in, Brother Batch said, "You going to be on that door?" I said, "I'm going to be on that door." He said, "Well, when you're done, take it home with you." So if you come in here one day and see that door missing, you might as well just stop by the house and pick it up. That's apostolic legacy. Oh, my God. Hallelujah. What a wonderful God we serve. What a powerful move. I look at Brother Joe over there, and I don't know, I guess it was 2004 or 5 when your life was on the line. Nobody expected you to make it. But yet he's sitting here tonight because of apostolic legacies. Think about Brother Grady and his wife. And Brother Grady was the rescue worker, the paramedic first on the scene. Didn't even know anything about the church. Testified, he thought he left him for dead. Would never see him again. But because he got a little heart fondness for Ashley, he showed up and he saw Joe. And Joe said, "You know, that night you helped save my life." He said, "I'm going to teach you a Bible study and I'm going to help save your life." You don't get no more apostolic legacy than that. Praise God. I could do this all night because there's so many opportunities. I think about in my own life how that 2.5 years ago I had a real bad attack from gallbladder. Did not know that I even had a gallbladder problem. Had a stone. They said it was lodged in the trifecta, which is, some of you medical people probably know better than I do. All I know is that it put me into pancreatitis. It put me into colonitis. It put me septic. It got into my bloodstream, the infection from it, because the organs were shutting down. The liver was shutting down. Amen. My wife laying across my bed, and I was kind of in and out, crying, calling on God. Calls and lets the church know, pray for my husband. He needs help. They tell me that they're going to have to go in there if they could even get it out. They're going to have to send me over to Big Duke. Put the claw down there. I didn't like the sound of that. I really didn't like the sound that they was going to have to do it and they weren't going to put me to sleep. I said, "I don't want to have nothing to do with no claw, but this pain's got to go. I can't take this much more." But thank God for a praying church. That was on Saturday. And they said, "Well," and I was scheduled to go to be transferred. And I was so unstable, they couldn't do it over the weekend. So I was going to be transferred on Monday. It stabilized me. It's working to get me stable. He said, "We're going to send you back down to radiology. We want to just do another dye test, check you out. Thank you. And take a look at this." They went in there. The first time they'd done that, it was so lodged up that the dye come back out of the syringe he was trying to put it in with. And the doctor told me, he said, "I've only seen 3 of these in 36 years. He said, "So you got a problem." Well, anyway, praise God. They went in there, done the dye test, went fine, come back, said, "Hey, it's gone. It's gone." That's apostolic legacy, my friend. Amen. And I just said, "That's another stone the Lord rolled away." Ow! Woo! When you're down and you're in need, you better thank God where you go to church and who to call and who you can trust, who will move for you and get a prayer through. Oh, my God. Don't want to have nothing to do with no claw. You may be seated. Matthew 7 and 13. Enter ye the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the way, and narrow is the way, which leadeth unto life, and few be there that find it. Now I learned this morning to read this real slow and clear and enunciate, because this might be all you get. Still learning. Still paying attention. Matthew 22 and 11. And when the king came in to see the guest, he saw that there a man which had not on a wedding garment. And he saith unto him, friend. Friend. Not enemy. Not demonic, hello, but friend. How camest thou in hither not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. I know what that felt like. I'll explain in my testimony in just a moment. Then said the king to the servants, bind him hand and foot, take him away, cast him into outer darkness. There should be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called. This is where I wanted to get to. Many are called, but few are chosen. This is some real serious word here. Real serious word. I want to appeal to your American culture and history for just a moment, so I can lay a foundation. It was Tuesday, May 20th, 1862. The American Civil War was just over a year into battle, and already the nation was worn, torn, and battle weary. Desperation and panic had swept the nation in earnest, regardless of the battle lines or which side they were on. They were looking for a way to provide hope for a better future. President Abraham Lincoln, working with Congress, signed into the law the Homestead Act of 1862. This act created or granted citizens or future citizens up to 160 acres of public federal land, provided that they lived on it, they improved it, and they would pay a small registration fee. They were given up to 5 years to provide proof of land improvement or lose their gift. Over the course of the program, more than 270 million acres of land was given to more than 1.6 million homesteads, with the hopes that a generational legacy, that's a gift or land or something of great value, be handed down from the past to an ancestor or predecessor so that they would be born. Someone who precedes you would be born. Most of the land was in the Wild West, completely undeveloped. Frontier challenges were many. Tornadic winds, wildfires from lightning strikes, torrential rains, freezing blizzards and plagues of insects or plagues of insects had to be overcome. Remember, they had to improve the land. They didn't just walk out there and drop a little seed in and there you go. It didn't happen that way. They had to clear the timber. They had to plow the land. They had to clear the, and man, they didn't have no John Deere tractors back then. Hello? They had Bessie and Sally, and they hooked them up to a plow, and they cultivated that place. And when they hit a rock, it didn't just pull it up. They had to go out there with their hands and dig that rock up and get it out of that field. and then keep on going until they hit the next rock and the next rock and so on and so forth. So it wasn't easy building a homestead to have a legacy to pass it down to their children or their grandchildren. But yet, they fought the rains of torrential rains, freezing blizzards, all these things. They had to dig wells and they had to move streams and get things moved around so they could water it. Oh my. Don't know if it's looking so good right now. First, it took everything you had to get to where you had to go. Then you had to go out there and spot the land that you wanted. Then you had to race everybody else to drive a stake in it and put borders around it. Then you had to send that and fill out the form and send that back to the government. That was all dangerous stuff. And then they had to go ahead and do the breaking once they got it, of breaking the ground, putting all their blood, their sweat, and their tears, and it required everybody to help. From the children to the seniors, it was all hands on deck. Just so they could build something that one day in future generations they could hand it down. These homesteaders were a very tenacious bunch. They understood the gift that had been given them, and they were willing to give it their all before they would quit, surrender, or die. They raised their children, their grandchildren, and even great-grandchildren on that homestead so that one day the legacy of handing down their homestead to the future generations would come. If our forefathers were this tenacious to hand down the gift of a highly sought-after homestead, the Temple of Pentecost should be no less tenacious in handing down the gift of biblical apostolic truths of all our future generations. Hallelujah. I remember Bishop Huntley preaching, remember, we're only one generation from losing everything that we've got right here, right now. So here's my legacy. Here is my testimony. Roll forward from the Homestead Act of 1862 to August the 10th, 1955. 93 years later, an 8-pound, 10-ounce brown-eyed boy was born to Jack and LaVon Wall. I had a humble upbringing and was instilled with strong Christian core values. My loving parents provided structure, rules, and guidance, along with correction and discipline when needed, and sadly, much more often than I liked. I deserve more. We'll keep that under the blood, Lord. Amen. I was raised in a denominational Christian home. Through the years, I had a great childhood and relationship with my two brothers and sister. As a teenager, I felt conviction in my home church, walked the aisle, shook the preacher's hand, and was congratulated for an open profession of faith. I was later baptized in the name, or I should say the title, of Father and Son and of the Holy Spirit. They were scared to say ghost. I was there, I know. I was told that I was good to go to heaven. And for years afterwards, while I was expecting more but never really felt complete or full, there was an emptiness in this little teenage boy. 16 years old, sitting, or 15, I think it was, when this took place. Sitting, my custom was, pick the last pew on the right-hand side, close by the door. As soon as service was over, first one out, could beat all them guys, going to stop by and drop their cigarettes off outside in the butt, though. Had to burn one. I seen all this. I witnessed all this. Come from this. Thank God for Temple of Pentecost putting our young people up on these front rows. That's apostolic legacy right there. I didn't have that. Hallelujah. I done all the things I was supposed to do. Joined the Boy Scouts. That's good. I enjoyed that. I was an outdoors guy. I was in the Royal Crusaders, which was their version of Boy Scouts in church. I did that. Played on the softball team. I did that. But I was still empty. I was still just barren inside. So on this particular day, I can remember it. I can see myself almost as a third person sitting back looking down. I'm sitting there, and I had my friends all on the left and on the right, but Bishop Dunham was my brother. I had nobody to help me. I was not disparaging anybody. We were doing what we knew to do, and that was all we knew to do. So we were doing all we knew to do. But I knew that there had to be more. So I remember this thought, then I got conviction in my heart when I said it. I said it in my heart, but I think one of the boys beside me said, "Did you just say that?" And what I said was, if this is what heaven's going to be like, I don't think I want to go. That's where I was at. Because it was not enough for me. Well, as we move forward, I kept going back to this word here, because the strait is the gate, narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. But by now you figured out there's an exception to this story for me to be able to be here right now. The good news is, it didn't end there. Somebody say, praise God. You want to know something else? The good news is, if you're here, it don't have to end here. I don't care what shape you come in. Don't care where you come from. Don't care about your history or your background. Amen. You're here by a reason of God, and you need to take advantage of it. If you're not part of an apostolic legacy, you need to start building one right now. You need to make the sacrifice right now. If you're empty, this is where you get filled. If you're hungry, hey man, this is where you get fed. If you're thirsty, this is where you get something good to drink. If you're sick, this is where they'll pray you through and get you well. Woo! Many are called, few chosen. How do I get called and how do I get chosen? That's where I was at. How? They're not telling me how. But God was listening to my thoughts, reading my mind, put his hand on my heart, and he already started moving to make a way. I didn't know it. Sometimes God's preparing the way, but he can't tell you about it yet. That's apostolic legacy. Oh my. Listen. Rolling forward. Fall of 1971, young teenagers, we call it hot rodding, as guys would call it, but the girls would call it cruising. They go cruising, we go hot rodding. I can neither confirm nor deny that I had drag races up and down Guest Road. I probably could, I might need to repent on that. But as was our custom, there's a little stretch of road in Durham that you would drive from the Hardee's restaurant down to the Honey's restaurant. And we'd have so many cars there that you would lock all the way around both restaurants and up and down Guest Road. And it was just a moving change. You had to wait for the longest time just to get in line. It was a parade of everybody's car, hot rod, person, whatever. My cousin and Al and I were riding together this particular night, and he had earlier met a young lady named Barbara who happened to be a very close friend of Sister Kathleen Thomas, who was Kathleen Turner back then. Wave your hand at her. Y'all remember? Y'all know Sister Kathy? Got some good turkeys on her land, don't you? Well, she had just bought a brand new 1972. Back then, you could buy a 72 in 1971 at the end of the fall. She bought a brand new 1972 first car she ever had. Chevy Candy Apple Green Nova. With a 350 even. That was a big block back then, bud. And you hot rodders, you know what I'm talking about. So previously, he had met Barbara, and as we were going down Guest Road, Al started punching me. He said, "There's a Green Nova." He said, "Pull in." I said, "I can't get in there." He said, "Make a way." So we found a way to cut across there. Squealing tires may have been in there. I can't confirm or deny. So I pulled into the parking lot at the 7-Eleven, wheeled that Comet around, man, popped that thing back in gear, backed that thing straight up. The windows were already down, because back then we didn't have air conditioning. Not in the car, no way. Just barely got it into our house by then. And so we backed up. Barbara was on the other side, but driving was Sister Kathy back here, which happens to be my wife's cousin. If you knew that or not, but you learn a whole lot of things on Legacy Night. So she was there, and but somebody else was in the back seat moving around, and I peeped out the window and I looked, and I saw this great big huge slurpy icy cup with a straw, and I saw the most beautiful blue-eyed wonder of this world sitting back there pulling on that straw. And as a good friend of mine, he said, my heart went potato, 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 potato. Woo! Little did I know she was third generation apostolic. Amen. So that's where it began. That's where I needed it. You know, if there ever was a thing called love at first sight, buddy, I had it. You see that look I'm getting over there? Her, not so much. It didn't work in reverse. I couldn't even hardly get her to talk to me. My aviation career began that day. I folded up a piece of paper I had, made me a paper airplane, and I aimed that thing, boy, and I just whoop, and a gust caught it and stuck it right in Sister Kathy's hair. I hope you didn't think I was flirting with you. Danny was on the way back then, sister. Somebody say, praise the Lord. I'm telling you, it grew, it blossomed. Months later, I told her that I was in love with her. She looked at me, sister, right in my eyes. She said, you better not. Am I preaching truth out there, baby? I'm telling you, better not. She's going to get me good. But my charm and my extraordinarily good looks and God, well, combined, we just somehow won her over. Where you go to church at? I go to a little apostolic church. I said, well, can I go with you on Sunday? Her daddy said, yeah, if you're gonna see her at all, you're gonna go to church on Sunday. So Sunday I was there. Be honest with you, I wasn't really there for the preaching. I wasn't there. Hello. I walked into that church, little old wooden floor, and man, I'm telling you what. Them chairs were rocking. People were shouting. Man, I was only fashionably 15 minutes late. But boy, they was full bore, wide open into it. I didn't know whether to sit down, shut up, run out, leave, forget it, I'm done with this. She grabbed my arm and just pulled me on down there and set me in the seat right beside her. We've learned a few things since them days, but back then, you know, we was breaking ground. Over a year, close to a year and a half, I proposed to her on the 24th of December of 1972? And this time, Sister Huntley, she said yes. Woo! I told you we'd win her over. For the first time in my Christian life, I felt fullness in my spirit, joy in my countenance, cleanliness in my soul, for I had found what I needed. You see, because the other part of that was, in February of 1972, I was baptized in Jesus' name. Started living like I had the Holy Ghost before I ever got it. Spent many two-hour sessions in the what I call the rope-a-dope, men that circle around you and pass you around, praying for you. Get the Holy Ghost. They were serious. If you weren't, you would be before you left. 2 months of that, in April of 1973, oh, God filled me with the gift of the Holy Ghost, and I become a first-generation apostolic, and I was full to the brim. Come on, let's give God some praise. Here's the kicker. If he'd do it for me, he'll do it for you. And he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I just determined right then we're going to start building an apostolic legacy here. Ooh. I'm skipping some stuff, so, because I think God is there. The question is, will you choose him? Because it said, many there be that find it. Now, like I said, if you're already here, you've already been called. Now, will you choose to put apostolic in your heart? Will you choose? I had to choose. And I chose that I wanted to get baptized in Jesus' name because Acts 2:38 told me I had to, and that was the right way to do it. So although I'd done been baptized, it was null and void, man. I needed to get it in the real name. They said, the name. And these apostolics, man, they knew where the name belonged, and they knew what it was. So you see, I had to choose. Many are called, few are chosen. It's not so much God choosing you out of a bunch, because he said he came that no man should perish but have everlasting life. You see, he don't want anybody to miss it. Here's the thing. Every time we're praying for somebody for the Holy Ghost, Jesus, I think, is in glory. And he's looking down and he said, I'm pulling for you. Come on. Just a little further. Come on. He knows the heart. I don't. But I tell you one thing. Nobody wants you to have it more than Jesus Christ. Nobody wants you to have an apostolic legacy more than Jesus Christ. And we got to protect this generation that we have and all the future ones that are yet to come. Amen. I look around, I see these young men and these long preachers, and my heart just got to swell up with apostolic pride, because God's doing something. God's doing something. God's preserving. God's protecting. And it's all to your blessings. Oh, my. Okay, so here, it's a gift. And you know what? You don't even have to have an apostolic mother or father. If you get this thing, you're first generation. You know what? And you say, well, I don't have no children, but you can give it to your coworker. You can hand this thing down. You can hand it down to your friends. You can hand it down to your enemies. You can hand it down to the stranger. Amen. But you know what? If God gave it to you, you got to hand it down. You got to hand it down, the gift of generational, biblical, apostolic truths was handed down on my wife's side. Grant, with a holy heart, I say tonight, I'm a little bit envious of you because, man, you were born in this thing, fifth generation. What a blessing. What a blessing. Your son, Charles Elijah Wicker, is going to be our sixth generation. And Amber, we don't know the name of yours yet, but whatever it is, they're going to be in it. Jordan, I know you ain't got nobody spied out, but a bunch of them are spying you out, buddy. I'm just going to tell you this way. Hold the line. Hold the line. First generation apostolic grandmother, Now the ones I'm going to list tonight are people that I personally met and witnessed their testimony, knew they were baptized in Jesus' name, and knew they spoke in other tongues because my ear heard it and I witnessed with it in the Holy Ghost. Her grandmother, Effie Cox Turner, handed down, that's her dad's mother, handed down the gift of biblical apostolic truths to her son. Second generation, apostolic father and mother, William and Mary Turner, handed down the gift of generation Bible apostolic truths to their daughter. Hallelujah. Third generation, apostolic daughter June Turner, now Wall, in the summer of 1965, received the Holy Ghost at the age of 10 years old, and she handed down the gift of apostolic truths to her daughter and to her son. Oh my, what do you do here? I tell you what you do. You take your children to church. Hello? You take your children to church. You take them to summer camp. Hello? You put them in Bible quizzing. Hello? You put them in children's choir. First time I heard Grant speak was right here on the night we got coming up this coming Wednesday, I believe it is. Heroes in Training. Amen. He started his training. How y'all doing? Now look at him. Now he can look over. Huh? You know why? Because we wanted them to have what we had been given. We wanted to hand down to Kimberly and to Brandon what we had been given. Hallelujah. And I'm going to tell you what, it worked, because fourth generation apostolic daughter Kimberly Wall-Wicker in June of 1988 at District Camp in Ohio received the Holy Ghost at age 11 and handed down the gift of biblical apostolic truths to her daughter and two sons. Fourth generation apostolic son Brandon Darrell Wall on the door over there. Remember the door? Sunday morning, July 1990, after returning home from a camp meeting in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, that night, Saturday night before service, he said, at 6 years old, he said, I'm going tomorrow and I'm going to get the Holy Ghost. 6 years, don't tell me they're too young. No poking, no prodding, just carrying, praying, supporting, and living it in front of them. Sunday morning, altar call was given. Brandon, first one pops up, walks down to the altar. Oh, and then he starts talking into them. What are you going to do with that? That's apostolic legacy right there. You know what? We went home. Said, I tell you what. He said, he's in the back seat of the car. He said, whew, glad I got that done. Now, I know I'm embarrassing you, son, but you know what? 37 years later, he's still full of the Holy Ghost. He's still working in God's house. He's having a dangerous job at times, but God has took care of him. Amen. The devil tried to kill him when he was born and take away his heritage, but God intervened. God moved for him when the doctor said he can't make it, and he's fine. He made it, and he's here tonight. I'm talking about it pays to have an apostolic legacy. Just another minute or two. Fifth generation apostolic granddaughter Amber Brianne Wicker, daughter of Kimley and Brian Wicker, received the Holy Ghost here at the Temple of Pentecost. Sunday evening service, October 2003, at the age of 6 years old. And you know, sometimes you wonder, are you doing the right thing? Let me show you some confirmation here. That was the first Sunday service that Sister Wall and myself and Brandon came here in transition, and that this was going to be our home. And how did God reward me? Sunday night, my granddaughter receives the gift of the Holy Ghost. How much more do you need? Come on, church.
How much more do you need? This is worth everything, every price, every stone, every stump, every thorn, every heartache, every problem. It's worth it all.
Stay standing there, Grant. Fifth generation apostolic grandson, Charles Grant Wicker. Daughter of Kimberly and Brian Wicker. And Brian is not just a son-in-law. He is family. He is my son. He's my other son. First generation Holy Ghost. Amen. But he's building a legacy. He's building a legacy. Right here. Temple of Pentecost Sunday service, April 22nd, 2007, at the age of 7 years old. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God filled my son, grandson with the Holy Ghost. And there he is here preaching right here at the Temple of Pentecost. What a legacy. And on March 24th, as you already heard, March 24th, 2023, or thereabout, Grant and Aaron Wicker will begin to hand down the gift of generational biblical apostolic truths to their son, my future sixth generation, and I almost say present because he's alive and well right where he's at. So you know where I stand. Sixth generation apostolic great-grandson, Charles Elijah Wicker. And I believe they're calling him Elijah. So tonight, would you stand? Tonight, we went from the Homestead Act of 1862 and appeal to our American culture. Oh yeah, I got Jordan. What happened to Jordan? Did he get deleted? I told you I was going home, hit the delete button after you preached this morning. I must have deleted. I'm trying to remember what the date was. Do you know, Kimberly? Come on, Mama, tell me. April 3rd, 2010, right here at the Temple of Pentecost. Bible quizzer. Bible quizzer. Hello. Children's choir. Went to the Nationals. Good old dad said, I'll drive you on the church van. So he drove them down and he drove them back. Oh, there's some stories to tell about that. But we won't touch that tonight. The future is bright, my friends. Forget about all the hubbub in the world right now. It's going to do what it's going to do. But if you've got an apostolic legacy to hold on to, I promise you that Jesus Christ is going to get you through everything that you got to go through. And you'll stand up here one day and you'll say, I'm so glad that somebody started a generational apostolic legacy in my life and poured themselves into it. Hallelujah. Oh, I had a whole other message, but I'm out of time. I had a whole another portion that was all about speaking to the parents and the first generation parents that are here tonight and the second generation that are here tonight and how much that you need to build your legacy now. Don't wait till they grow up. It's too late. You got to start now. When they don't want to get up and go to church, they're going anyway. When they're hungry, if you ain't got it in the house, they're going to be hungry after church. They'll survive. But you got to put a priority. And if you want them to shout in church, you need to shout in church. Hello, if you want them to give in the offering, you need to give in the offering. You want them to tithe when they get older, you need to give your tithe. And I know I'm probably trespassing here, but I'm just telling you something. There's something about this episode, Lex. You cannot wait. You cannot wait. And like I said earlier, I don't want to leave anybody out. I got a personal heart for first generation apostolic because that's where I came from. I come this close, Bishop, to missing it. Because I was not on any path that would ever have got me here. Amen.
There was not a path that was going to get me here that I could see. And I stand in here looking back as honest as I can. There was no path for me. But a little 15-year-old boy sitting on the back of the pew, reaching out trying to catch flies and shake them up and make them dizzy. But my heart was sincere. This ain't enough. There's got to be more. There's got to be more. There's got to be more. Hallelujah. If you want to, why don't you just come down to the altar for just a moment. I'm going to turn the service back to the pastor. But if you're already in a generational apostolic, come on down and let's pray for those who are not. Let's pray for you. Why don't you grab your children, your grandchildren, if they're here. Take just a moment to pray for them. And let's trust God. Let's believe God. Let's love God. Because He's so worthy of it. He's so worthy of it. Build it. Build it. Don't be afraid of it. Grant, your message was perfect. David said, I can't build it because I'm a man of war. God told him so. But you know what? He said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you all you need to make it happen. Grandparents, that's what we need to do. Give you all that we've got to make it happen. Pouring ourselves into our children, into our apostolic heritage right now. Come on, let's talk to the Lord Jesus. Talk to the Lord Jesus.
I want you to pray over your family right now. I want you to lay your hands on your children's head and pray for them. I want you to pray over their mind. The devil's not going to get their mind. The devil can't have their body. The devil can't have the things in their life. They've been dedicated to God. They've been given to God. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus.
Be free as for me and my house.
next generation than apostolic truth, apostolic faithfulness. Because people have passed on millions of dollars to their kids. Their kids spend it on everything of this world that this world has to offer. Their life often is destroyed on drugs, alcohol, and riotous living, as the Bible says. But when you pass along apostolic truth, you leave something that will stand the test of time. I grew up on an apostolic pew. In fact, there were many a Sunday night I was under the apostolic pew. In fact, my little brother was 4 years old, and he looked at my mom and said, "I'm so tired." She said, "Baby, you can go to sleep. Just lay under the pew and go to sleep." And he said again, "I'm so tired." She said, "Go to sleep." He said, "I can't." He keeps hollering and pointed at my dad. My memories of vacation or going to general conference and then going somewhere fun afterwards or before. Vacation trips, it's church. We're going to have church. We're going somewhere. We'll have fun. You know what? I don't regret one of those memories. Not one. I don't regret coming to church on one Sunday night. I may have been tired. I may have felt like I am worn out. But I thank God for the legacy that I grew up in apostolic truth. Don't let your children grow up in something that's strange to even you. Don't give up on the faith. Give up on what God's put in your life and say, "We're going to give them an easier route." If it was good enough for you, it's good enough for them. Don't give your children an easier route. Narrow is the gate. And so Luke chapter 11 says, "And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place," speaking of Jesus, in a certain place, in other words, he'd been there before, "when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him," these are disciples of Jesus, they should know. He said, "One of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples." If you don't teach them, someone else is going to teach them. If you don't teach them, a school system's going to teach them, or people that have other ideals of this world's going to teach them. You need to teach them the book. Don't wait till Sunday school teach them. Thank God for wonderful teachers. They've taught all of my kids, but you need to teach them first, and then it is confirmed at church. In fact, Brother Wayne McLean said that years ago. He said the preaching of the Word of God should be confirmed because you should be in your Bible at home reading, and God will confirm it in the pulpit. And so confirm it to your kids, and there's no greater gift that you could give. Why don't we raise our hands right now and thank God for this legacy of apostolic truth. I thank you, Lord, for the wonderful families that have been a part of truth. I thank you, Lord, for successful generations of people that have been in truth. But I also thank you, Lord, for those that are first generation that are determined to continue this legacy in the lives of their children and the following generations. I pray for your blessing, your touch. Thank you for the word we have heard tonight. In Jesus' name, can we appreciate Brother Wicker, Brother Wall, preaching, wonderful tag team, our wonderful ministry, music ministry team for leading us in worship tonight. What a great evening. What a powerful evening. This Wednesday, our heroes in training. It's going to be a great time. This Saturday, at the time we normally do our prayer, we're going to have communion this Saturday, the Lord willing, from 8 until 9. We'll receive communion this Saturday in our normal prayer time slot. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. The church is open 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Monday through Friday. Please stop by the